This is the season two of the Wharton Entrepreneurs Workshop, put on jointly by Wharton San Francisco and our firm, Wilson Sonsini, Goodrich and Rosati. My name is Herb Fockler. I'm with the corporate and business law group here at Wilson Sonsini. And we are absolutely delighted to be able to partner with Wharton San Francisco to put on these presentations, these tutorials on entrepreneurship. We put on about eight last year, and now we're starting it up again this fall, and we hope to have about one every month, or maybe even a little bit closer than that, over the rest of the fall and the spring. Today, we have the valuation game, how to make points or not, in negotiating to reach a fair term sheet. We're delighted to have Carl Showalter of Opus Capital with us. A couple of housekeeping things as we get going. The next presentation is October 4th. I need to increase the size of that a little bit because you can't read it, but it's October 4th up at the Wharton campus in San Francisco. We'll have Jack Abraham, who's founder and CEO of Milo.com, come and talk about doing it, insights from an entrepreneur. And this is going to be a theme for our present tutorials this year. We're going to have more input from entrepreneurs. Last year we had a fair amount on legal issues and accounting issues, and this year we're going to try to provide more on the business side. So we hope you'll all attend October 4th, same time. Just to remind you, we've got a number of these workshops available online. You can find it through the Wharton website, but you can also just put in to YouTube, Wharton, and a lot of these come up. I know if you put Wharton in my name, it comes up immediately for my presentation. There's eight up there right now. Actually, seven. Also, after today's session, we're going to try something new. A number of partners from the firm here will be available in the room for any informal questions that you might have about any legal aspects of starting a business. Generally, we've had a number of people stay around and ask questions afterwards, so we're going to formalize it a little bit and encourage you, if you don't have to rush out to get to your work at 9, to stay and ask any questions. Let us help you however you can as in starting a business. So, now to the main event. Carl, thank you very much for joining us. Carl is a general partner at Opus Capital. He had 12 years of operating experience before coming to Opus at Juniper, UUNet, ANS, Belcor, and in various positions in sales and marketing. And he holds a BS degree in systems engineering from UVA and an MS in engineering economic systems from Stanford. Opus itself is an early stage investor in technology companies looking taking a long-term perspective and looking to accelerate growth in early stage companies with $1 billion under management and 80 successful outcomes, including 50 IPOs. That's quite a track record. So we are delighted to have Carl here today. Thank you for joining us, and I will turn it over to you now.
Thank you very much. So thanks for giving me some time to speak this morning. As Herb mentioned, I spent about 12 years in various companies that were small and large. And when I came to venture at the end of 2002, I always wondered, okay, so how do venture capitalists figure out valuation? And what is the secret recipe they have? And you know, is there a class for it? And do you have to go to school and so forth? It turns out to be pretty simple, and I'll go into a bit of that today, among other things. So in terms of the valuation game, I'd say the most important thing I'd like to get across is the perspective I'm coming from is very early stage venture. And as a result, generally when I'm working with entrepreneurs, there's no revenue, there maybe is no product. I'm just getting to know them. So the negotiation and the discussion around a term sheet is a very important part of the process and perhaps the last step to seeing if this is somebody that we should spend the next 5 to 7 years with helping them build their company. And so I want to talk about some of the more subtle points and some of the more specific points around negotiating a term sheet. As was mentioned, we're very early stage investors in information technology. We look for entrepreneurs who can see around corners, folks who see markets before they exist, can figure out how to apply technology to those markets in a way to create a market-leading company. We focus primarily on seed and Series A as our entry point. We have an information technology focus across wireless mobile, internet, enterprise application software, infrastructure software, and semiconductors. And we continue to raise funds every 3 to 4 years of around $200 million and put between 25 and 30 companies or investments in each of those funds. There are four of us who make investments. I'm going to point out a little bit of the backgrounds. Dan immigrated from Israel in 1989. He was one of the first employees of a company called Electronics for Imaging up in San Mateo. He was the first VP of engineering. What EFI did, which was interesting, was take color printers and turn them, or color copiers and turn them into color printers. So basically the print controllers to turn copiers into printers. He then became CEO of the company after it went public in 1996 and retired from there in 2000 at the grand old age of 33. He took a year off and then started another company called Decrew, which was at the intersection of storage and security, encrypting your social security and other data at rest. That company was bought by NetApp in 2005 for $300 million, and Dan joined us after that. Bob joined us about 2 years ago. Bob started his career at a startup that was bought by Nike and really created the Nike Fit program. He then went to Nokia, and then in 2004 was recruited to Apple to help be the first product marketing guy on the iPhone, and spent from 2004 to 2009 as the senior director of product marketing at the iPhone. My partner Gil has been investing for 25 years, both at Weisbeck and Greer Venture Partners, Lightspeed, and then Opus. Before that, he was founder of two different companies, one of which he was the CEO of, which he sold to Lockheed. And myself, I started my career at Bell Corbell Labs. I then went to a startup that was bought by America Online, spent a couple years at America Online, then worked at a company called UUNET on the East Coast, where I was the general manager of their dial and DSL business. And then at the end of 99, came out here to join a company called Juniper Networks, which had just gone public, and I was the VP of Marketing and Product Management, and then came to the dark side of venture capital at the end of 2002. So if you look at the early stage criteria, and this goes into some of the things we're looking at in the term sheet, we're looking for teams that see markets before others do, that can see around corners because of experiences they've had or training and knowledge they have of particular markets. The markets, we actually don't want people to come in and say, it's a $1 billion market today. We want them to say, it could be a $1 billion market, or it could grow, here's a market that could grow very fast. And the reason for that is startups really, if it's already a $1 billion market, it's hard for startups to compete against much larger companies. But if there's a company or a segment of a market that can grow really fast, that's where startups have the advantage to apply technology and to apply their expertise to create a market-leading company. And we see that time and time again. And from a technology perspective, we're looking for some level of intellectual property to create some barriers of entry. But the most important thing I would say is, including the above three, is how do you have a capital-efficient business model that has very scalable distribution? Turns out most of the companies that we fund do not, the ones that don't make it, it's not because their technology didn't work. It's because they couldn't figure out how to scale distribution, they couldn't acquire customers efficiently, and they couldn't generate revenue fast enough. To provide a little background on the discussion around term sheet negotiation, I have a very early stage view. So when I'm talking about term sheet, I'm talking about the first term sheet. The term sheet where this is the first money in, first institutional money in, there's not an existing term sheet we're building on, this is the first time. And when we look at some of the aspects, generally there's usually very little revenue or no revenue when we're talking, so there's no comps. I can't go to the entrepreneur and say, you just had $10,000 worth of revenue, the current market comp is 3x revenue, so I'm going to pay you $30,000 pre. It doesn't work. That's not a reasonable comp process. Usually the team is not complete. There's usually a very strong business, perhaps CEO, a very strong technical founder, but we usually need to add salespeople, marketing people, additional engineers, so it's very early in the process. Usually the market is very small and very early. Maybe there's a couple of competitors that have gotten funded or are in the process of getting funded, but from our perspective, it's important there not be 40 or 30 competitors because it's too hard to pick. And finally, the most important thing that we can figure out in that first negotiation is how much money is it going to take to get the company to a point at which it can raise additional money at a much higher valuation that's less dilutive to founders and also not dilutive to us as well, or less dilutive to us. Although we put more money in, so we don't get diluted, but it's how do we get that up round in 18 to 24 months? If you look at some of the key aspects of the term sheet that I want to talk about today, one everyone focuses on, of course, the cap table and valuation and so forth. But there's some other important ones as well, such as what's the structure of the board? You know, what are these things called liquidation preferences, and why do they matter? Protective provisions, what are they and why are investors asking for those? And then there are a number of other considerations I'll hit on lightly. Everyone wants to know about the valuation. Let's first start a little bit background on some of the fund economics. So if you take a typical fund that we raise around $250 million, we invest approximately $6 to $7 million per company over the lifetime of that company. Usually to Series A, we put in $2, $3 million, maybe partnering with another VC who puts in $2, $3 million. But over the lifetime, we're looking for about 25 to 30 companies in the portfolio, of which we invest in those new investments for the first 3 or 4 years of a 10-year fund. The people that entrust their money to us, the limited partners, they're looking for us to return over a 10-year period about 3x or more their money back to them. So in this case, if we had a $250 million fund, they're looking to get $750 to $1 billion back from the companies we invest in over that 10-year period. On average, we try and own 20%. It helps make the model work. And in every deal that we invest in with regards to the Series A stage, we're looking that over the next 5 to 7 years, all the money we put in, we can get at least 10 times our money back over that time period. That's the driver for us. And so when we look at opportunities, we have to think about the amount of money in and the amount of money out, and therefore, most importantly, how big the outcome could be. So for us, if we invest $2 or $3 million in a Series A, and maybe another 3 to 5 over the next couple of years for a total of 8, we'd like to be able to take at least $80 million out of the company, which means it's gotta be about a $400 million exit if we own 20% at the end. So that's kind of the math that we're looking for, and one of the reasons that we drive for more ownership, because obviously the more ownership we have in the company, the lower the valuation can, the lower the ultimate outcome can still impact the fund in a nice way. And believe it or not, I know it's hard to believe, but not all the companies that we invest in work. And there are lots of reasons why they don't work, but we know it's gonna happen. But the fact of the matter is, when we invest, we have to fundamentally believe that each of those companies can return about 10x the money. And here's a typical business-to-business Series A cap table. Now, I say business to business because there's a whole bunch of social web, consumer web, that have a bunch of more complicated structure I'll hit on a little later. But typically when we go into an enterprise software company or a semiconductor company or a systems or technology company, the cap table looks kind of like this. The founders have about 40% after the Series A. Each VC has about 20%. And there's about 20% in the option pool or ESOP for current and future employees. That varies in a number of ways, depending on a number of issues I'll get to in a minute. But if you look at the valuation approach, what we really care about is how much money is it going to take the entrepreneur to get to that meaningful milestone whereby they can raise more money? Because it's very rare that companies get to profitability on this first, call it $4, $5, $6 million. They usually get a product in the market, they usually get some early customer feedback, they usually get to build up the team, but they're not yet profitable, and they really need some money to go to expansion stage later. And so as we think about setting up the Series A term sheet, we're trying to make sure there's a structure that allows enough money to go in the right structure that allows the company to get to that next milestone where they can raise more money at a much higher price. So an example here is if you had an enterprise software company that had a prototype product that you could demo, and customers said, ooh, if they could build that, that would be really cool. If it took them $6 million over the next 18 months to reach $1 million a year in customer revenue, that means get the product finalized, get it into beta, get it through beta into revenue, and have them start generating revenue, then you know, one model would be to have two venture capitalists come in with $3 million each and provide and have a $9 million pre, $15 million post. So effectively, if you think about the breakdown, there'd be, again, 20% for ESOP, 40% for founders, 20 each for the VCs. And what we're betting on at the $15 million post is that sometime, if no more money went in, sometime in the next 5 to 7 years, the company would be worth $150 million. Usually that's not the case. It usually takes another one or two more rounds with additional money from additional investors. And a typical, in this case, enterprise software company, successful ones take 20 to 25 million over the life of their company in order to get to a point where they're worth hundreds of millions of dollars, four or five, 600 million. And sometimes it's even more, depending on the economic climate, whether you know we have depressions, recessions, or everything else, and things don't always go perfectly. So the assumption is it's 25 million is probably the minimum, and it's probably somewhere in the order of 30 to 35 for a healthy company to get to profitability in a position where they get acquired or potentially go public. So what can change this model? What changes the reality of this 20-20-40-20? Well, first and foremost is when there's competition for the deal. When there are competing term sheets that and there are different investors who want to get in, that can raise the price of the round. That can also cause VCs to compromise either on the ownership they have or they end up putting more money in to get that ownership. Another variable is the entrepreneurs themselves. If the entrepreneurs, as a venture capitalist, if Mr. Smith has made us money two or three times in a row or even one time in a row, is willing to put some of that money into this company alongside us, that will definitely change the structure. We have a case where one of the companies we work with today, the entrepreneur, we put in approximately $10 million in 2004, and he sold the company for $400 million in 2008, which means we took out $80 million from that sale. We then funded him again about 2 years ago, and he put in $4 million, we put in $6 million, and he owned a big chunk of the company in addition to his founder shares because he was able to do that. So this does change the structure. In this case, he effectively took the place of the second VC. In addition, you have things such as angels, the angel investors, micro-angels, and so forth, who put money in earlier, and that can sort of modify the cap table, and I'll show an example of that later. If you think about the board and the board structure, the first, second, and third rule that matters is, in my view, get an odd number board. And the corollary to that is the smaller the board, generally the better. Because the reality is that the Series A, whether you have three or five, every series of stock you have after that is going to, you're going to add a board member. Because generally, if somebody new comes in to lead the round, they'll want a board seat. But the fundamental lesson for me has always been have an odd number board. And the reason for that is you do not want a stalemate. Early in my career in venture, I was one of the other portfolio companies in a fund I was in had an even numbered board, and it came to be a very important decision about whether to replace the CEO or not. And the fact of the matter is there were two members of the company, a founder and a founder who was CEO, and two board members, and they couldn't agree on whether the CEO should be replaced or not. And what literally happened was 9 months of arguing while the company ran out of money. And until the company ran out of money, the founder's CEO said, I'm not going to give up this post. And the investor said, well, we're not going to put more money in until you do. And so it came to this stalemate. The company ended up getting a new CEO, actually doing all right. But it was one of those cases where 9 months were wasted because there was this governance structure which didn't make sense. And so then the question becomes, how do you determine who are the five or who are the members of the five? Generally, you sort of want to line it along the lines of the cap table, but the general view that we have is two common shareholders, usually one of whom must be the CEO. Assuming you have two VCs who each own 20%, two VCs each who take a board seat, and then an outsider. And here comes the trick again. How do you pick the outsider? And generally, it's one of two ways. It's either everybody voting together on the outsider, which again can promote a stalemate if there's contention. But the better way to do it is have one class of shares, either the common or the preferred, nominate, and the other approve, and have some language about not reasonably withholding approval. So you can only reject two or three candidates. That way you can break the stalemate. It's amazing because the board member piece of this gets to be very emotional for young startup companies because people want to be on the board. And unlike on the public company side where no one wants to be on the board, in the private company side, it's actually an honor and to be on the board in some respects. And you have to work through how you're going to select those board members as part of your term sheet negotiation. And one tip, don't try and do this. Let's say you found a VC firm you want to work with and you decide, you look at the partners there, and you've been working with partner number A, and you say, well, gee, it'd be much better if partner B was on the board. You can hint at that, but you can't really ask, because VCs were kind of sensitive, and if we think that you don't like us anymore, and you like our partner better, it leads to a tough dynamic. So just keep that in mind. It's very difficult to sort of dictate to the VCs themselves who is the board member, unless they're misbehaving. If they're misbehaving, you can sort of demonstrate that, Carl comes into every board meeting and I sleep and I, read my BlackBerry, then you probably have cause for doing that. The second piece of this is liquidation preferences. There's lots of emotion and so forth about that, but what this is really intended is a simple liquidation preference is when the company is sold, investors get their money back first before anything else happens. And that's the simplest form of it. That's just a 1x liquidation preference, which is in almost all the cases what is done. The part that gets trickier is something called when the liquidation preferences have participating preferred, meaning not only do I get my money back, but then for the next set of dollars that are distributed among the cap table, I also get my share of that as well. And that's participating preferred, and sometimes that's capped. So for example, in a $100 million outcome, let's say I put in $8 million and I own 20% of the company. I would get my $8 million out, and then of the remaining $92 million, I would get 20% of those proceeds if it was participating preferred uncapped. Many times what we do to make it a little fairer is cap it at 2x or 3x. So that after I get 2x my money or 3x my money, I get no more money. And then at the beginning of the process, I have to decide whether to convert to common and participate as common at my 20% all the way across, or whether it's more advantageous to me in this case to have a 2x or 3 to do the 2x or 3x. Longer explanation, but there's math here, and there's a lot of good websites that can sort of take you through this, but it's subtle because people focus on liquidation preferences, but they miss the subtlety of what it means by participating preferred, and they're two different things. One is off the top, and the other is as you participate as the proceeds continue to come in. My preference is, as a Series A investor, is I want a 1x liquidation, I want to get my money back if it's sold, or I want to participate per the cap table. I don't want participating preferred, and the reason for that is one of the things that I'm negotiating with when I'm negotiating with founders at Series A is not just with them, but also with future investors. Anything I do that I put into a term sheet sets a precedent, and investors come back later, that's the B round investors, the C round investors, and so forth, they then begin to see what I've done and they sort of add value on top of that. And so the simpler I can keep the structure, the better off it is for me and for the team when we go to negotiate future term sheets. There's another set of things for preferred shareholders called protective provisions. And when you negotiate a term sheet, you'll see a whole list of things that require either a preferred vote or a board vote or a combination of preferred and board vote. And these are things such as sell or merge the company, raise additional financing, create more shares, take on debt, change the size of the board, dissolve the company, change the structure of a preferred class. There's a number of things that we as preferred shareholders want to make sure we have a say over before they're effectively done to us. And my advice here is these are very normal terms, but as a founder, as an entrepreneur, what you don't necessarily want is you don't want a single VC firm to be able to control all of these by having blocks on all of these. It's much better if you have two VCs for them to agree, if you have three VCs for two of the three to agree, that one can't block. Because then you sort of can get held hostage by somebody. If firm X has the ability to block any future financing, they can hold out for some additional favors or some additional value in order to get that vote. And that's just a waste of time, and it makes it for pretty poor governance inside the company. So keep in mind, if any one investor has a block and why they need a block, the one place I do push for a block is if I control a series of shares, meaning if I have majority of them, I don't want the terms on those shares, the terms, the preferences, and so forth, to be changed without my permission, which I think is only fair. But when there are multiple of us, then it ends up becoming a lot easier. number of other considerations include anti-dilution. There are a number of different ways to, anti-dilution is basically when there's a down round, there's some mathematical formulas to give existing investors additional shares to help minimize their dilution. And so what this effectively does is shift the ownership from the common to the preferred in the case of a down round. There are a number of different calculations invented by really bright people on how to do this. Broad-based weighted average is the simplest one and actually the fairest one from a structure perspective to the common and to the founders. It's the one I always push for. The fact of the matter is, in most cases, when you have a down round, you end up waiving anti-dilution because you're trying to get the company financed anyway, and so it doesn't come into play. But if you're going to have one, pick this one. It's the most, I would say, company-friendly one. You also will be asked in the term sheet to validate employee vesting. And that really includes both current employees as well as future employees. And you know, the standard practice these days is, of course, 4 years with a one-year cliff. Now, the more interesting part of the vesting negotiation comes around. I'm a founder. I've spent the last 2 years bootstrapping this company. I've now finally gotten Carl to invest, and he wants to reset the clock to zero again and have me start over with my investing for the next 4 years. That's a negotiation. And usually what we do is we want to have some additional vesting. We vest some of the shares, the founder shares that they already have, try and spread it out because we want them to be motivated and we want them to have the precedent of having a multi-year vest so that they can say to their employees as they hire them, I'm in the same boat as you are, but we also want to recognize the fact that they may have worked a year, 2 years to get to this case. I had a company a couple years ago where the founders had worked 2.5 years, had built a really cool prototype product, and you know, were looking to be, you know, 2.5 out of 4 years vested upon the Series A funding. What we ended up doing was taking a chunk of their founder shares, investing all of those, but then taking another chunk, investing it over 4 years. We agreed on it. They agreed it was fair, and you know, they've all been there for now 4 years, so it worked in both ways. If you look at the drag along, bring along, or voting trust, what this is preferred in general want an ability when they believe the time is to sell the company, and they don't want to have a lot of legal work to get all the various major and minor shareholders aligned to do that. And so this ends up being a trust where anybody who has a certain percentage of stock agrees to vote their shares for an acquisition if the board approves it. And so it's a pretty standard term these days, but it doesn't mean there isn't emotion around it, particularly for founders who are no longer with the company but still own a large share of the stock. If they believe the company is being sold for the wrong reasons or at the wrong time or to their disadvantage, this can get to be a much more emotional issue. The next piece that really we as VCs try to sort out during this process is, what are the founder roles and, you know, what do they want to be? There's, you know, we fund many companies at Series A where there is no CEO, and we're okay with that. We agree, the founders sometimes are superstar technical guys or marketing folks who just say, look, I'm not ready to be CEO. As part of this process, let's jointly go find a CEO. And that works great. Many times we fund founders where the founder is a CEO, and the founder CEO ends up being ultimately the successful founder of the company. That works as well too. The question is sort of the middle mark, where one of the tests that I'd like to do during the negotiation is, if there's a founder who wants to be CEO and perhaps it's the first time he's ever been CEO, what's more important to him? Is it more important to him that the company be successful or that he is CEO? And how do we sort of manage that dialogue and so forth? And so for me personally, what I do is, if I believe the founder CEO is ultimately not going to be the long-term CEO, I tell them that before I give them a term sheet. Because I don't want them to feel like I'm being dishonest with them or I'm not being upfront with them about my expectations. Now, in many cases, I think the founder CEO can be CEO for at least the next 18 months, 2 years, until the product's in the market. But maybe they're more technology-centric and haven't scaled an organization or scaled a sales distribution process. I want to have that open conversation before we get to the term sheet or as part of the term sheet process. Because what I don't want is, I don't want to have monthly board meetings where the founder feels like if anything goes wrong, he's in trouble. And therefore, he has to hide information from me, or he has to sort of put on an act to convince me that he should be CEO. I want to have this open dialogue, which is, are you in fact, you know, what's the expectations for the CEO? How do you feel about being CEO? How do I feel about you being CEO? And how long does this, how long do we feel this continues? And what would cause us to change our minds and go find a separate CEO? But our preference, quite frankly, as investors is, if we can fund the long-term CEO at the Series A, that's far and away our preference, because it minimizes a whole bunch of disruption and distraction for the companies. It doesn't always happen, but it is our preference. And then there's a term that's gotten more exciting recently called automatic conversion. And what that does is, with some sort of threshold, you can force the preferred shareholders to convert to common. And there are reasons to do that around an IPO and so forth, but there are other reasons to do that. And so you got to be very mindful, again, of the thresholds here, of whether that can be, whether anybody can block it, and if they can block it, why, or if anybody can force it to happen on others. You just have to be mindful of thresholds. One of the most important parts of the term sheet is math. And people say, well, math is basically, yeah, how much is the pre, how much is the post, how much is the price per share? That's important. But the other math are all the various thresholds in it, in terms of protective provisions, automatic conversion, the number of board members. Just be mindful of these numbers, because they have a lot of meaning. So with all these items, how do I really approach this process? What do I do? First and foremost, I sit down with the founders and say, okay, what are the key milestones we need to get to raise additional money? How much money is it going to take? How much time is it going to take? How much time is it going to take? And then let's add a little bit of cushion, because stuff happens. It doesn't always happen as per dictated on the spreadsheet. And as a result, we come up with a number. And it's usually, again, enough cash to get the company through 15 to 24 months, depending on the space and the sector, in order for it to have probably some early revenue, definitely some customer validation, and so forth. It varies by sector. Enterprise software, you want revenue. In a semiconductor company, that first money just allows you to go tape out the chip and get early samples back. So it varies by industry and so forth. The second question I ask myself is, do I want to do this alone, or do I want to do this with another VC? So I don't want to do the whole amount myself, or do I want to partner with somebody else? What do I think the value of the company could be in 5 to 7 years? And then the negotiation starts, because, you know, my view is I'm locked into this 20% number, and I've as one variable that I've locked, and then we try to lock into the amount of money raised, and then the term sheet and the cap structure sort of falls out of that. But the most important part of this process for me is, again, I'm investing at a very early stage, and I probably meet the founders over a period of a couple weeks or maybe a month or two. I've got to get to know these folks and see how they work and how they think. And they've got to get to know me and see how I work and how I think. And this negotiation of terms is a very important process. Keep in mind, once we invest in companies, we have monthly board meetings. And if we're talking 5 to 7 years, you know, that's 60 plus board meetings over that period of time. And if it goes as long as 10 years, it's 120 board meetings. That's a lot of time to see somebody. Hopefully you can communicate with them and you actually don't mind seeing them. I mean, it's a key part of this is dating. You know, when you're raising money from a VC, it's a little bit like early dating. Do you trust this person? Do you want to spend the next 5 to 7 years, you know, with them asking you questions? Do you value their advice? And using the term sheet process as part of that determination is important. So here's a little bit of advice to potential founders as they think about investing and taking money from investors. First of all, before you go up and down Sand Hill Road asking for money, do a bunch of research. Look at the space the company you're building in. Do some research on firms, on partners who have relevant knowledge, experience, expertise in the space. Look at the stage they tend to focus in. You know, if you're raising a Series A fund, look at funds that focus on Series A. Check references. Look at the companies. We all have the companies we work with on our website. Talk to some of the companies that we've worked with. Find out what we're like to work with. We're all human. That means we all have pluses and minuses. We work better with some people than others, and sort of try to match it up before we even start walking around with an investor pitch on Sand Hill. Come up with 5 to 10 firms. My view of it is, if you don't get somebody interested in your idea in the first 10 firms, doing 40 more firms isn't really going to help. So really do some research, pick 5 or 10 firms and go for it from there. Get introduced to the partners by some trusted advisor, some intermediary that knows both of you. It's very unlikely that if you just send me your, if I've never met you, if you send me your proposal over email, it's very unlikely that I'll end up funding you. Just to give you a view of the numbers game, I probably look at on the order of 400 business plans a year. I meet with probably 100 of those, and I fund 1 or 2. So it's a very, very, you know, tough pipeline to get through, just because my charter is to do 1 or 2 investments a year, and I want to see as many as I possibly can. Now, in the spaces that I'm really focused on, it's probably more like I see 40 or 50, I meet with all those, and I fund 1 or 2. But if you just send me a random business plan, it's a tough probability that it's actually going to get an investment. Think about, as I said earlier, think about the first meeting as a first date. Not only should I be qualifying you, you should be qualifying me. Am I interested in what you're doing? Am I excited about it? Do I offer to help? Am I engaged? I think it's a very important aspect, because you want to get a partner, a financial partner and an investing partner, who's as excited about your business as you are and can help you in many ways to build that business. Once you do all this and you meet a number of VCs, the trick is to keep the VCs sort of on a similar timeline, and then get a term sheet, and then get a second term sheet. Frankly, the best way to negotiate, and the best advice I can give you on how to manage, work with the VCs on a term sheet, is to have some leverage. And the best leverage is options, meaning multiple term sheets. Once you get multiple term sheets, the structure that I've talked about, you know, can be modified quite a bit. The second piece to think about is, many times as you're negotiating that Series A term sheet, you get myopic on the terms of that sheet and the deal as it is. Recognize that this is probably not the only money you're going to take, and as a result, you need to think about what's going to happen with the next round, what the structure that you do now, and that's why I vote to keep it simple, what the structure you do now is going to imply for future rounds. The second piece is, carefully think about who's a founder, how you allocate shares among founders, how many founders you have. The toughest thing is, if in fact there's 30 to 40% for founders, that's a substantial amount of equity to spread between 2 people. It's a nice amount to spread between 3 people, but when you get 4 people or more and you decide to make it equal, it starts to get smaller, and also it's unclear if 4 founders will indefinitely be equal. And so I've worked with founding teams where the 4 founders split it equally initially, and I've worked with teams where the 4 founders have split it disproportionately, depending on who's doing what. In the end, it usually ends up being disproportionately, because as time goes on, some founders stay with the company, some founders leave, some founders do more, some founders do less, and as additional grants are given, the board makes a decision of who's providing value. But if you start with that equality, think carefully about it, because it sets a precedent, and you're liable to have difficulties down the road if you always have to keep all the founders equal. And I think the biggest, or one of the most difficult challenges we find in the Series A is companies, bootstrap companies, they start up, they have their friends help them, they say, hey, yeah, if you do this for me, I'll give you a couple shares. If you do that for me, I'll give you 1% of the company. Winklevoss twins notwithstanding, there's a lot of verbal things that happen that, you know, really don't rear their ugly head until the company's worth $50, $60, $70 billion. And then suddenly everybody who was ever promised anything verbally comes out of the woodwork and says, hey, you remember when you promised me this? What's that worth now? We've had experiences where young entrepreneurs, 22, 23, you know, get taken advantage of by older, more experienced guys who say, hey, I'll help you raise money if you give me 5% of your company. And they never write it down, and it's all verbal. So my advice is, before you promise anything to anyone, think about what you're doing. And secondly, write it down. Have a written down process. And it's, you know, not to be advertising here, but that leads to my last point, which is not on here. Get a lawyer as soon as possible. If you're thinking of starting a company, work with a lawyer. Work with somebody from Wilson. Work with a great firm, a great partner. They'll help you with incorporation, and they'll help you avoid a whole bunch of pitfalls that I, as not a lawyer, am not qualified to warn you about, but they can certainly help you. This is a little a different cap table that I just wanted to go through quickly. This is a case where there were some angel investors that put in $850,000. They had a 15% discount, so that was worth a million shares at $1 a share. Each VC put in $2 million. The founders got 3 million shares, and the cap table breaks down like this. And assume that it was $1 per share after the Series A. The reason I want to show this is I want to show what happens with regards to dilution as you go through an additional series of stock. So again, founders at 30%, each VC at 20%, angels at 10, and the employee option pool unallocated or allocated is at 20%. So let's say you go and you go out and raise a Series B at $4 a share. So remember, Series A was at $1 a share, Series B at $4 a share, which is a fantastic up round. That's a great, you know, that's a great price if you can get it. And so you've gone from being on the approximately $10 million post to $46 million pre, and you raise an additional $10 million Series B to expand. The founders themselves, because they don't put additional money in, have gone from 30% ownership to 21% ownership. So you can start to see why if you have a lot of founders, that the equity in the company of all the people having founder shares starts to get smaller and smaller pretty quickly. And this is the best case. There aren't that many companies that can go out and raise $5 million in round A and then get a 4x markup on a Series B 18 months later. So this is a good case. So think about when you're thinking about the cap table, when you think about the dollars you're taking in the Series A, do a mental map of here's what we think will happen with Series A, here's what B, C, here's what we expect to own at the end. As founders, how do we want to split this money? How do we want to allocate that and so forth? So, you know, valuations today. Valuations vary quite a bit by sector. Right now, you know, if you're deciding to start a semiconductor company, it's not an easy time to get it even funded. And if you get funded, you're not going to get a great valuation. If you're starting a social web company and can get angel money or micro VC money, you can get some pretty amazing valuations these days. And, you know, stratospheric even, because people are working off comps such as Groupon, Facebook, and others. My view of valuations are it's not a cross the board thing, it's a sector thing. Depending on how hot or interesting or what the comps are in a particular section is going to drive some of the relative valuations of what you get. I also believe that it's very hard to use comps in a Series A because you have no revenue or you have very little revenue. As you get further in your progression, Series B, Series C, the comps become much more relevant. But the hotter the space you are in, the more VCs will be looking at it, and therefore potentially the more you'll get bid up if you have a great idea. My concern with starting a company in a hot sector, meaning I was happily teaching school and then one day I thought it'd be really cool to start the next Facebook, is that chasing a sector that's already hot is usually too late. These companies, the great companies, take 5 to 7 years to build. These trends are much faster than 5 to 7 years. You know, we've had, in the last 8 years, we've had nanotech, we've had clean tech, we have social web, we have the cloud now, a lot of things. These trends last 4 or 5 years. Some continue indefinitely, but they modify and morph. And trying to hit with a very early stage company, a hot sector can be tough. I think it's better to sort of find an area where you fundamentally know, where you believe you can apply technology to that area, and build a company in a market that you believe is going to happen, and it's going to happen very fast. You'll be much more successful. So to summarize, you know, the term sheet process. When I talk to entrepreneurs about a term sheet, it's a negotiation, but it's also a dialogue. I want to see how flexible they are. I want to see do they understand what's important to them? Do they take strong positions on things that are important to them? Do they back off things they don't really care about? How do they interact with me? Because for the next 5 to 7 years, we're going to have continual dialogues. We're going to talk about budgets, we're going to talk about spending, we're going to talk about strategic objectives, we're going to talk about hiring. So for me, the term sheet is the last step I get to really understand how entrepreneurs think and how they react and, you know, who they are. As I said, we're all human. We all have strengths and weaknesses. And the key part of that is, you know, trying to understand if you're going to be able to work with each other as part of this term sheet process. We do a ton of research on people before we fund them. We talk to the references they give us and the references they don't. We talk to people who've met with them. We talk to people that may have known them. We talk to a ton of different folks to try to get a picture on who they are. The mistake that many entrepreneurs make is they don't do the same thing to us. They assume that because we as VCs are on Sand Hill Road or something, we must be good, blah, blah, blah. We're all different. We all have different strengths and weaknesses. We all are human, and it's important you understand, you know, how we react under stress. How, you know, whether, you know, what kind of style are we? Are we very supportive? Are we very critical? You know, what are you looking for from a VC? What kind of interaction? Do that research. And then, a bit like dating, but focus on finding a partner that every time you interact with them, you get more excited about the opportunity to work with them. And you're more excited about your idea. And you feel like they're really bringing to you ideas and thoughts and making you think in ways that are going to help you build a better company. Because that's what we're doing. You know, as I meet with, you know, 100 or so folks a year, the ones I keep coming back to and meeting again and again are the folks that, ooh, there's a spark there. I really like what they're doing. I see this opportunity. And as a result, you know, I want to spend more time with them. I really want to flush out this idea. And interestingly enough, you know, I've had a couple of successful companies I've worked with where the first idea someone brought me wasn't the one I funded. We talked about the first idea. We talked about the pluses, the minuses. We ultimately decided not to invest in that idea. But the entrepreneur came back with a separate idea or a third idea. And we ended up funding that idea because we liked the way they thought. We liked the way they attacked markets. And we really wanted to work with them, but we wanted to work on a market that both we and they were excited about and that we believe they had a really interesting insight into. And so again, when you're trying to make points with a VC, figure out what's most important to you. What do you care about in terms of the valuation? Think very clearly about how much money you need and where it takes you. And think very clearly about, is this the person I want to see every month or maybe every week for the next 5 to 7 years? Because if you really can't stand coming to see me, then you really don't want to take my money because I'm going to be around you quite a bit. Thank you. So I have lots of time for questions, and I'm happy to take any questions that you might have.
I got a quick question. So for Series A, average $4 to $6 million, how often do you take the whole thing versus split with a VC, and do you have a preference?
So I skipped through it a little bit.
Can you repeat the question?
Sure. So the question is, for a Series A, call it $4 to $6 million, how often do I invest alone versus invest with another investor? So most of the time it's with another investor, and there's a couple of key reasons, and there was a slide that I think I skipped through quickly on it. One is, I've invested alone a couple of times, and the dynamic that ends up happening inadvertently or whatever is, instead of being seen as an investor, I start to get seen as an owner, because I'm the only investor, and so they start treating me differently than they would if I had another VC beside me. They start asking me permission for everything. They start, you know, really saying, "Is it okay if we do this?" And that's not the. I'm not there every day, every hour. I don't want to be in that position. That's one risk of taking a single investor. The other risk is, and it's not obvious, but it many times feels if you only take money from one VC, they end up owning 30, 35, 40%, somewhere in that range, maybe 30. But when you go raise a new round, the new investor looks at this kind of differently, like, okay, well, I'm only gonna own 15 or 16%. Carl's gonna own 30-odd percent of this. That's not really gonna be balanced. Whereas if you have two investors who own, call it 20%, and you bring in a third of 15%, it's just a little better balance, kind of. But the other question is, how much money does it need? If the company's only gonna need $3 or $4 million ever, and I fundamentally believe it's gonna get profitable on that, I probably wanna own as much of that company as I can, and so maybe I will do it alone, $3, $4, $5 million for 30%. It just varies by situation. But as an entrepreneur, I would be careful of, if you have one, making sure that you don't sort of get a de facto CEO in accident because you now have one investor. It's much better when you have two that can balance. Plus, you get the leverage of two networks. I tend to, when I do investments, I tend to want to partner with someone who's more financially focused than I am. My background is marketing, product management. I want to think about the product strategy and those kind of things. And I'd like to have a VC partner who's more in tune with valuation and future fundraising and those kind of things. And if you can get two different skill sets on your board from VCs, I think it's a great way to proceed.
Do you have a preference in terms of anybody approaching you if they already have an LLC or an S-Corp, or it doesn't make any difference?
So the question is, do I have a preference on whether it's an LLC or an S-Corp or so forth? We generally, in every case we can, force it to be a Delaware Corp. And we just push it for that for U.S.-based companies. Obviously, we also invest in companies based in Israel. There's different structures for that. But for the U.S.-based companies, we really look for them to be incorporated in Delaware, wherever, whenever possible, just because it's easiest for us.
When you're talking about the different terms, you often brought up the word emotion, and how emotion can lead to perhaps less than rational behavior. In the process of getting to know
So the question is, what are some of the things that I do during a discussion with founders to mitigate things getting too emotional or too heated? And I assume you're talking about during the negotiation.
During the negotiation, before the negotiation, as well as some of the things that founders can do to make sure that things
aren't too emotional. Yeah, so what are some of the things that founders can do to avoid getting too emotional? First of all, recognize as a founder that this company is your baby, but it's just a business. And so trying to sort of separate the love and passion that you have, which is so powerful in making it work, from sort of somebody critiquing it. Because you know, effectively what I'm doing is, as in the early stages of talking to you as a founder, I'm trying to sort of fast select as fast as I can. You know, get as many reasons not to invest on the table as possible, so I can figure out, you know, whether this is something that passes all those gates or not. And so whether it's advertent or in my case inadvertent, I'm not really trying to offend you. I'm just trying to test your thinking on sort of how do you get to market, you know, what's the distribution, who are the partners, why is the product differentiated, who are your competitors. I'm just asking you a bunch of questions, and you just can't take it personally. And most of the folks that are really successful don't. They view it as, hey, you know, I should be able to answer these questions. This is good. This is a good exercise, or this is a good process I'm going through. And oh, by the way, that's what I'm going to do to you for the next 5 to 7 years anyway, so you might as well get used to it. But in terms of the emotional piece, it's important to recognize that, you know, at least for me personally, I'm not trying to offend you. I'm not trying to insult you. I'm just trying to understand how you think about your business. Now, when it comes to the term sheet discussions, it's an interesting dynamic because you're negotiating with somebody that you're going to work with for the next number of years. And so, you know, it's really important to understand what is most important to you and try and figure out what's most important to me and figure out where the conflict points are and how you resolve it. And part of that, again, is a test to see if we can work together. But, you know, I'll give you an example. I've spent the last 2 weeks negotiating a term sheet with a founder, and there were multiple potential investors. I found out yesterday morning that I was not going to win it. I found that out because somebody else came in 50% higher than I was willing to pay. And, you know, at the end of the day, I think because I'm, you know, self-confident, I think that the investor is making the wrong choice to optimize for valuation at this particular stage. But by the same token, you know, my view was, hey, good for you. You got what you wanted. You know, I hope this works out for you. I'm not going anywhere. I'd love to be able to continue to help you. And maybe if there's a time in the future where we intersect, I could invest. We occasionally make late stage investments. So I try not to take any of this personally. I also try to recognize that it's a difficult process for all involved. And the most important piece is being clear on communication.
Do you have any words of wisdom on when it makes sense to go straight to VCs for seed money, you know, trying to get one of these big early rounds versus going to angels, you know, doing something in the tens or hundreds of thousands and doing more product development and more work that way?
So for me, my advice is if you can take a small amount of money and massively change the value of your company, you should do it. Because, you know, the trick in startups is being as capital efficient as you possibly can. So if you can take a little bit of money, say 100,000, 500,000, 400,000 from angels, and get to a point where in a year you can get 10 pre, 15 pre, 20 million pre, that's a lot better deal for you than trying to raise, you know, 3 million on 3 million pre kind of thing. I mean, it's an obvious statement, but it's that works well in sort of social web companies and internet companies. It doesn't do any good in a semiconductor company, because on $500,000, all you get to do is say, okay, I've now talked to all these people, and if I had this chip, they would actually maybe buy it. And here's a bunch of guys that if I had money, they might come work for me. I mean, so you can't. So you need, you know, $5, $6, $7 million to get going and build a chip. Much different in a more capital efficient space like web and so forth. So I'm a believer in leveraging angels. There's another aspect of this for things that are sort of B2C, business to consumer. There's a whole bunch of that which is more, and I'm not trying to be insulting, but a little bit fad, or you know, it's hard to tell what consumers will like. And so if you can go figure that out on 200K, you can do that a lot more efficiently and spend a lot less money, and you'll know, versus trying to raise $4 million and then do the, you know, you spend the first 500K, realize you're wrong, pivot, spend the next 500K wrong, pivot, and you start to annoy your investors. You know, pivoting has become a really fashionable term, but as an investor, I'd prefer the companies I work with didn't have to pivot. I'd rather them see the market, go after it, and have the product they got win. Now, when they have to pivot and they succeed, that's great, but plan A is just get it right the first time. In the back, yeah. Okay, remind me to come back to the second one because I have short attention span. I'll try to do the first one. For the first question was sort of depending on the industry, what are the valuation ranges that we're seeing? And it's not an easy question to answer because companies decide to raise Series A at many different stages of development and with many different levels of experience. So I'm not trying to weasel out of it, but an example is we funded a company this past April where the founder was a very experienced product manager out of a big company in that space. And he had a very good idea that he had basically whiteboarded out. And we invested $1.5 million at $3 million pre to own a third of the company. And basically the $1.5 million allowed him to build the product or finish the product and launch a couple of partnerships. And he's now raising money at a much higher valuation, you know, 6-7 months later, because he has proven some of the things that needs to be proven. And he's now sort of entered another band of accomplishments. So, you know, what I'm generally seeing is most of us in the early stage are holding to the 20%. And so what's happening is in many cases there are, you know, it's 40% going to investors and 60% going to management and so forth. But what's happening is people are raising more money. So instead of it being the example of, so 4 on 6, so 4 million on 6 million, it's more like 10, 12 pre raising 7 or 8. So people are raising more money at the early stage at a higher valuation, but still giving up a big chunk of the money. Where that's different is the angel funded deals, where there many times the angels themselves start to look like one VC, and then a new VC comes into the Series A and does the whole Series A and maybe owns 20% of it. But again, from semis is the hardest right now. Software, as you're a software as a service and you have revenue, you can get, you know, you can get 10, 15 pre, depending on how far along you are in revenue. And then in the internet, in the web space. It's just all over the map depending on what your comps are. Gee, Evernote just got funded for $1 billion, so I got to be worth at least 15 pre. I mean, it just it depends on what the comps are. On forced conversion, you know, it, again, it comes down to the thresholds. And the question was around, you know, what I'm seeing is typical for forced conversion. And it really what you want as an investor is I want to block. I don't want to be forced converted without my saying so. And in the Series A, I tend to hold to that. But as there becomes more than two investors, then it's usually two of three or three of four or so forth that they can get it done. So one can't block if there's a total of three and so forth. Other questions? And the Wilson guys can answer that better than I can because they see these things every hour, every day.
The automatic conversion of preferred to common, does that benefit the VCs?
No. Okay. Not usually.
Right. So you say it's becoming a popular trend. So
no. I'm saying it used to be a part of the term sheet we didn't look at because the only time it ever came into play was during an IPO where, you know, you no longer have preferred, you have common, it's part of that. And the lawyer, you could be much more articulate than I can on this particular subject. But for whatever reason, people are now using forced convert in interesting funding situations to change the cap table. And maybe you can comment.
Yeah, it's you're exactly right, Carl. You used to see it only as almost a throwaway part of the term sheet of, okay, we'll do an IPO, and it must be at least five times the Series A price and at least $30 million of proceeds. And what's crept in is a second branch where, with certain conditions and certain votes, you can force the preferred to convert into common when you don't have an IPO, sometime earlier. The whole theory is that, you know, as you get closer to IPO, the valuation of the preferred and the common should approach themselves and then become equal because once you're public, liquidation preferences don't matter. So we're seeing this in down round situations a fair amount because you might have a lot of existing investors who are tired or tapped out on money, and yet there's very large liquidation preferences that would be in front of a new investor coming in. We didn't see a lot of that in the 90s for the obvious reason is there weren't that many down rounds.
Yeah, it's basically a way for as a new investor, if I'm a late stage new investor and I see a good company that I want to invest in, but the company's already raised $50 million and has, you know, $50 million of liquidation preferences in front of me or in the company, in front of management, and I want to put in, I think I can put in $10 million and I can get this company to profitability and grow, but the existing investors don't want to invest anymore, then it becomes a dialogue of, do I, as a new investor, am I able to cram down or reduce their liquidation preferences maybe by half or something and force them to convert their other half to common as a part of getting this round done. So it's more around, it really started to rear its happy head during end of 2008, early 2009, where companies had syndicates that were falling apart or syndicates that couldn't continue to fund it, and as a result, new guys came in and tried to sort of change the liquidation structure, the preference structure.
Think of it as part of modifying the rights of the previous investors in a way that's necessary in order to bring in a new investor. And sometimes as the entrepreneur, you're just caught in the middle. You know, the new guys, the old guys, what are they going to have?
And then there is emotion.
Yeah. But it's the toughest, for us, it's the toughest legal issue.
Sure.
How many companies are you involved with at any point in time, and what do you think is an optimal dynamic for an A round versus maybe a B round?
So how many companies are you involved with at any given time?
Involved with in terms of have an investment in or
how many board seats am I on, or how many companies am I working with at any given time? For me personally, I've generally kept it around six. I've gotten as high as eight. And I felt it when I was eight. There are peers of mine who are on 20. I don't know how that happened. I don't know how you do that. But most of those guys, to be fair to them, aren't doing 20 A rounds. they're doing, you know, a couple A rounds, a couple Bs, a couple Cs, a couple Ds, and so they somehow they end up on 20 board seats. And when the IPO window isn't open, it just everything stretches out, and you end up getting on a whole large number of them. But for me, six has always been very comfortable. But I don't force it. If I see a great company, I'm on seven. I'll go on eight. But you know, generally the companies tend to get sold over time or go public or whatever. So I try to keep it that balance. But I think many more than six or seven or eight. If you think about it, I have a board meeting every month. Those board meetings are 3 hours. I have a 3-hour partner meeting every week. You know, at some point it starts to, you know, not be, you can't do 20. I mean, that would literally be, if you had a board meeting every month on 20, that'd be 60 hours a week, 60 hours a month in board meetings. And then you should spend some period of time before the board meetings preparing for them and so forth and so on. It gets kind of tough. But it's something I would check. You know, if you found Mr. Wonderful as the VC that you want to put money into your company and he's on 15 boards, you know, have him explain to you how that might work.
Carl, about how many companies would you be looking at actively at one point that you're really interested in?
It depends on the season, but it's usually between 3 and 10 that I'm sort of doing some level of diligence on and trying to sort of figure out as quickly as possible if it's something I want to push or not. But I probably meet with on the order of four or five new companies every week. And I try to quickly decide after the first meeting if I want to do more and so forth and so on. But it's an ongoing process, and it's seasonal. Everyone wants to raise money the day after Labor Day and the day after the first day of the new year. And a lot of people have figured out that another cool time to raise money is right after Thanksgiving, because sometimes they can rush it. They can try to get an end of year special. In the back. So the question is, you know, terms around angels that I prefer or don't like. What do I like? What don't I like? From a ex-entrepreneur perspective, I prefer convertible notes over priced rounds. I think giving up 10, 20, 30% of your company for 100, 200, 300K is just not really fair. I'd rather see guys get convertible notes where they convert. They provide it as a debt instrument that converts into the Series A at maybe a 15, 20% price per share discount or something. That's fair. It always hurts me when you see the 23-year-old who got 100K from his friend's father, and that friend's father owns 20% of the company, you know, 500K post. That just feels like he's been taken advantage of a little bit because he's given up a big chunk of the company. But again, from the father's argument, it's like the kid wouldn't even be able to start if I hadn't given him the 100K. So there's both sides to it. But for me, I tend to prefer when it converts into the A round. Other questions? I think I have like 3 minutes. Yep. Right there.
Do you see any interest rate on the convertible notes built into this kind of structure as well? And what's typical?
It's a good question. Usually it's minimal, but in the last year or two, it's gotten to be a little different. What do you see these days?
Yeah, it's usually not an issue that's talked about very much. It hasn't gone down to 1 or 2%. I think it's still somewhere between 6 and 10. Although 10 would be awful hard to ask for in the current environment. The more important point, I think, is the discount, as you were saying. The note will convert at 10, 15, 20% less than the conversion price or the price at which the preferred is issued. And then a lot of times the interest will be rolled into that too. So you look at them both together and say, effectively, I'm going to be investing at, however the math works, 25% discount.
This is typical. 850K turns into a million.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a 15%. That kind of thing there, where
maybe
basically
it goes on longer than, in effect, the discount gets lower.
Yeah, what you'll see is people who raise multiple rounds of angel financing. Maybe the early stuff is 20, 25%. Then as you get closer to the A round, it's 15%, then maybe 10%. It depends on when the money comes in and, quote, how risky it is.
But generally, interest rates and dividend provisions in the preferred stock, these guys aren't investing to make 8% of the money. If people are fighting about 8% or 6% or whatever, they should be in a different investment
Yeah, there's also a little different, and I'm not trying to be too controversial, but there's sort of East Coast term sheets and West Coast term sheets. Yeah. East Coast term sheets, they want to make their money coming, going, and every way in between. You know, we're just in it for, you know, when you sell the company, we want to take our percentage ownership and be very happy with that piece of the pie. And so most West Coast VC firms try to keep, at least at the Series A, the term sheets as simple as possible. And we don't do a lot of participating preferred, and certainly not uncapped and things like that. All the way in the back. Sorry, I missed the first part of the question.
So early on, founders get diluted for a variety of reasons.
Yes. Yes, yes.
And then later, the company's very successful or on a path to fairly be successful. Who opens up that dialogue and how?
It usually goes, usually the founders hint or the VCs know. I mean, it's one of those things where when you get a founder stake, it's 8, 10, 12% of the company, big chunk of the company. It's unlikely that you're going to ever get that much again because it's just it's a much bigger company and so forth. But I personally, having been on the founder side, I'm always mindful of the founders' clocks and sort of where they are in their vesting and so forth. And I always want them to have some, if they're doing well and if they're an important part of the company, I want them to continue to feel motivated to be part of this. And so, you know, for me, when we revisit employees' option grants every year and look at the structure and so forth, we include the founders and say, okay, does it make sense to do something here? And by the way, to my earlier point, in one of the companies I worked with, you know, where there were multiple founders who were all equal, that's where we started differentiating between them. One ended up being CEO. One ended up doing something different, one ended up leaving. I mean, you could start to differentiate that way. But for me, you know, there's a hard line that we VC sometimes takes is, these are the founder shares, that's all you're gonna get, go work hard. The truth of the matter is, as the company succeeds and goes and the founder is needed just like any other employee and the founder has options to do other things and them leaving the company would be a bad thing, I'm always aggressive on trying to make sure they understand that although they're not gonna get an 8% grant of the company, they might get a 0.5% or something that vests over some period of time that shows that they're still valued. And oh, by the way, you know, new employee, I mean, the way I gauge it is, what would it cost us to replace this person if we had to go out and hire somebody on the street now that they're fully vested? And if we're giving VPs a percent of the company, then if there's a founder VP who's fully vested and is, you know, critical to the company, they probably should get a percent, an additional percent for your grant.
I think it's interesting. The last two questions have a link to them, and no, it's seriously. And it's you know, when you are choosing, if you have the luxury of being able to choose an investor, finding one that you know has the philosophy that Carl has, you know, of working together, so that both of you succeed. I mean, this is one of the things, as you're saying, difference between East Coast and West Coast. You know, rather than the investors trying to extract an extra 8% here or 10% there, whatever, you know, the philosophy of both investors and founders and employees, we're all going to succeed together in all of this stuff, or we're not going to succeed. And as you said, you know, a founder who has been there in the long term and is producing, you know, not as a founder now, but as a key employee, a key executive, you know, the VCs are going to recognize that and reward that because that's part of everyone heading the same direction. So anyway, we're at 9 o'clock right now. We've promised everybody that we would let you go at nine. Carl, I don't know what your schedule is like, if you're able to stay a minute or two more, if there are any questions that people have. But we'll declare the formal portion over and say thank you very much for coming. This is absolutely fascinating, and appreciate it very much.
Thanks for listening.